Today on the Marketplace of Ideas, a conversation with journalist, memoirist, and world traveler Lawrence Osborne, author of Bangkok Days, a sojourn in the capital of pleasure. It's the Marketplace of Ideas. I'm Colin Marshall. Lawrence Osborne is a journalist, world traveler, and author of many books, the latest of which is Bangkok Days, a sojourn in the capital of pleasure, whose subject, I suppose, is obvious. Lawrence, welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
You mentioned in one other interview I read that there is a dearth of existing Bangkok literature out there, whether it's history or whether it's travelogue, like what you're doing or anything else. Why do you think there is so little that's already available?
It's quite surprising. I think Bangkok, until the recession, was the seventh most visited city in the world. And yet, it's a sort of, a lot of people go there, and yet perhaps it has not attracted the usual high culture crowd that goes to Europe. And it's not a phenomenon of long standing. People have been going there, maybe the last 20, 25 years, something like that. And perhaps it takes time for the West to digest another culture. And we're not connected to Southeast Asia in the way that we're connected to France or Italy or Spain or the United Kingdom. So there hasn't perhaps been time for there to spawn a new literary look at the place. But, Somerset Maugham wrote about Bangkok in the early part of the century, and there have been a few things. But I was very surprised when I wrote this book. I went to the National Archives dutifully every day when I was in Bangkok and was expecting to find a whole archive of literature, and found virtually nothing.
And when we think about Bangkok here in the, over, as you said, the last 20 years here in the West, I mean, of course, as you know, the image that comes to a lot of people's minds, especially those who haven't been there, is essentially one gigantic paradise of sex tourism. Now, as you describe in the book, that's not really accurate. There is more than that there. Why has that been the image to captivate everyone who is as at a distance from it?
There are lots of reasons. First of all, there's the Vietnam War, which made Bangkok into a kind of recreation zone for the troops. And I think that sort of image from the late 60s, the early 70s, became part of the whole mythology of Southeast Asia and that failed war. And the same, the same is also true to a certain extent of Saigon and Phnom Penh. But those places were overrun by the communists, and they were shut down. Bangkok stayed in business, as it were. And of course, it's not just the Americans who created Bangkok as their thing. I mean, there's a sort of indigenous sexual culture in Southeast Asia, which is ongoing anyway. Remember, Westerners are only 5% of the people who go to Bangkok for that reason. They don't by any means determine that scene. And the second reason is, I guess is what the Thais would say, was that Westerners are obsessed with it in a way that Asians themselves are not. That obsession says more about us than it does about them. I tried in this book not to write about very much sex business, because I felt that if there were some books on Bangkok, many of them were about this, and that I was a bit tired with it. I didn't really want to write yet another book exploring the bar girls, the whole thing. I mean, of course, I couldn't avoid it either, because you can't write a book about Bangkok and pretend that it's not there. That's ridiculous. It does define the tenor of some of the city. But Bangkok is a city larger than New York. I mean, it's a city of 10 million people. And in a city that has been there for hundreds of years, of course, there is, it's only a small part of what you have there. But of course, it's an interesting distinction. I mean, in the sense that what you have in Bangkok is a sort of, there are no more prostitutes in Thailand than there are in the United States, proportionally. It's just a question of its visibility and the way it's tolerated. And it's probably that morbidly fascinates us, simply because we don't do that anymore, or ever did. But it's just that's an area of life that we pretend is not there. And in Western countries, those things are regulated and repressed very severely. So when Westerners go to Thailand, of course, it strikes them immediately as something that's very difficult for them to digest. They obsess about it. I don't think Thais obsess about it at all. That's my impression, anyway.
judging by your goals in writing the book and keeping it from being entirely about the whole that whole industry in Bangkok, can I assume that the subtitle with the words Capital of Pleasure was the publisher's idea?
It was indeed.
Oh, okay.
I'm against subtitles in general. And when the you know, when my books, when anyone's books come out in Europe, the first thing you do is they drop the subtitles.
Oh, they don't have those there?
No.
Oh, well, that's a good thing, because, you know, there's so many authors I talk to who they have certain goals in writing their book, and they are directly contradicted by whatever subtitle the publisher has
given
them.
I know. And actually, I wanted the title of the book. The title of the book is a sort of homage to George Orwell, to Memoirs.
Sure.
A book I love. And I had thought that it would be self-sufficient. Title would be, an English guy reflecting upon a culture in that part of the world, as Orwell had done. I thought that would be enough. So it's mystifying, isn't it? I don't know. I mean, I guess there are marketeers who know what they're doing.
There is another confusing element to that subtitle, which is that it says A Sojourn in the Capital of Pleasure. Now, I'm not completely sure, because it's... What I appreciate,
that's right, yeah.
One of the things I appreciate, yeah, about your book is that you don't spend a huge amount of time on simply exposition of why you're there. You drop the reader in, and I really appreciate that. But it sounds like there are many individual trips. Is that correct?
Yeah, and I think that's actually true to life. I mean, that's actually how, I could say that my attitude here, I wanted to, I think that sometimes our relationship to cities is very much like our relationship to a person. It's almost like a love affair or a friendship. And if you think about the way in which you get to know a human being in all their complexity, it's something that happens over many, many years. And it's not about, you don't meet somebody in one period of time and then decide you have that they're a friend or a lover. I mean, yes, you do in some ways, but of course what you really do is you drop in over and over again. You get to know that person over a very, very long period of time. And when that happens, 10, 15, 20, 25 years, the accumulation of those visits, the accumulation of that time spent, it produces in you feelings of complex feelings that are, in the case of Bangkok for me, that were worth writing about. If I had gone there just for 6 months, just to write a book, I don't think I would have had that. I think it would have been a very different sort of texture. Whereas here, I could say that this book took me 15 years to write, because it was some total of all those many years dropping in and out. And as the city changed, I changed as well. So there's also that. The time, the water that goes under the bridge, the time that it's spent becomes, I hope, part of the texture of the writing itself.
How many trips are we seeing while reading this book? I mean, I'm sure I could, if I really put my nose to the grindstone, I could count.
I can't really remember. I mean, I think dozens and dozens and dozens. And actually, even since I wrote the book, I've been going back, because I often do a lot of journalistic work in Southeast Asia, and I'm always going through Bangkok. And my relationship to the place has changed even since writing it. That book was written in 2006. And of course, what's happened in Thailand since then has been quite dramatic. It's had this enormous political unrest. It's been a military coup. There's been a bloodless military coup, but a military coup all the same. And there's been a society, society is in crisis. I described a few demonstrations that I had seen when I was there in the winter of 2005, 2006, where everything was getting very weird. But of course, it's gone much weirder since. And last November, I was stuck in the airport when it was invaded by a gigantic crowd of protesters, the so-called yellows, which was extremely peculiar. I mean, I was in the airport waiting to fly to Tokyo, and 10,000 people stormed the airport. Some of them dressed in flowing robes and crying "Martyrdom, martyrdom." So it was, that side. It was interesting to me, because this country that was never colonized and that was never Europeanized, was never Westernized, has retained a social order which is entirely inscrutable to us. And what you're seeing, that demonstration, reminded me of how strange Thailand actually is deep down. And the political commentary on those events seemed absolutely nonplussed across the board. No one really knew in the Western media quite what to make of it.
To what extent can an outsider actually understand this social order? I mean, it sounds like our prospects are not good to truly grasp it, but since you're writing
you have to remember that, no one really cares much about Thailand in the West, even though it's a vital ally in the region. I would have to say, to answer your question, I would say one of the reasons why I wanted to write, another reason I wanted to write the book was that Thailand, of all the countries in the world, it's one of the very few that was never colonized. I mean, Ethiopia was never colonized, and nor was the interior of China, although many areas of China were colonized. So it's one of the very, very few societies in the world that does not bear our imprint at the deepest level. If you go to all the other societies in the region, whether it be Malaysia or Indonesia or Cambodia or Laos or Vietnam, all of them, they were all colonies at some point. Their internal furniture was rearranged by the Western colonial and bureaucratic mind. That never happened in Thailand, never. So you have this, perhaps the only society in the world that has been continuously uninterrupted for 700 years and has remained intact. And that's what its inscrutability is really all about, that it's a genuinely entirely Asian culture. Now, of course, on the surface, there's a great deal of Westernization in Thailand, perhaps more than anywhere else. That's the paradox. But I suppose the two things are connected. The reason why it's more Westernized is because it's less Westernized at the deepest level. You see what I mean? So on the surface, Bangkok, it looks like Blade Runner. It has all these sort of, spectacular LA-style, skyline and these forests of skyscrapers and luxury hotels, and very high-tech city, et cetera, et cetera. But it's deep, if we could be Jungian for a minute, its psychic structures are entirely non-Western. And it's the combination of those two things that I think is extraordinary.
How much of an experience did you have with Bangkok and with Thailand in general before, when you started to realize that there's something very alien going on at the bottom here, this psychic structure, or is that immediately obvious?
I think it's immediately obvious. I think it's immediately obvious on a sort of animal level, if you like. I mean, I travel, I was going there a lot when I was working for the Times magazine, and I was doing pieces all over Asia, and I would be in Borneo, or I would be in Papua New Guinea, or I would be in these places that are much more remote and much more alien than Bangkok could ever be on the surface. And yet, in a funny, paradoxical way, whenever I came back to my luxury hotels in Bangkok, I always felt that was stranger than Papua New Guinea. Thailand, something in Thailand was more unknown in some way, and I couldn't really put my finger on it. I still can't put my finger on it. To go back to the analogy of the individual, it's like an individual whose deepest recesses are not quite available to you, that you don't quite know what they are. And it's not a facile pursuit of mystery. It's not a facile love of mystery that draws you to that. It's a genuine enigma that is not... And in a certain sense, I could also say that I wish the whole world was like that. I think I write about these places... because I'm English and because it's we who basically colonized the whole world and made it into a kind of reflection of ourselves. And the British have a very specific role in that. And perhaps it's for that reason, and I come from a very British Empire family, it's for that reason that I'm extremely interested in the places that are not like that. It's why I'm drawn to China. I go to China a great deal. I feel it's in some ways also China is a place, the heart of China, the interior of China, is a place that has not succumbed to that sort of colonial problem. But in Thailand is much more seductively available than China is, because it's not a communist country and it hasn't been walled off from the rest of the world for the last 8 years. It's a place that has made itself available to the rest of the world. So I think that's those are my deeper reasons.
And if I recall correctly, in your previous book, The Naked Tourist, much of that was a search for a place that was truly alien. And you had that all along in Bangkok?
Yeah, I think, the two books are deeply connected. I mean, I think The Naked Tourist was also an exploration of the same thing. The book on Bangkok grew out of that book, actually. It's just that in The Naked Tourist, I looked at a bunch of countries, looking at the sort of tourist route that went through Asia and late 19th century and then led to the hippie trail and led to the modern tourist industry. When you look at a group of countries, you're always, the method of the book is always very different. You're basically looking at, you're using the countries as case histories and an argument. Now, in the case of Bangkok, I wanted to go deeper. I didn't want to do that. I didn't want there to be an intellectual method. I wanted it just to be a much more visceral, emotional book in which there'd be just a sort of flow of sensation and feeling. And to have that, to convey that idea of the city as a sensual, physical, organic, jungle-like place, and to render the human experience of living in a city of that kind. Well, all cities actually, in a way, are like that. That I find, and there's another issue as well, which is I think our cities have, the cities of the last 30 years have become these gigantic sort of super organisms. They're really unprecedented in human history. New kind of city, and in, especially in Asia, I think we are genuinely, sounds a bit Thomas Friedman-y to say it, I'm sorry, but it's like this sort of, this sort of new form of urban life, which a new urban civilization, if you like, which is arising. And in Asia, what's very interesting about Bangkok, and it's not true about other Asian cities, but particularly Bangkok, is that it's not entirely indigenous. What you have is, for all what I've just said, we have also created Bangkok as well. It's the foreigners who live there, the 100,000 people who are not Thai, who live there, who have created that city as well. So it's a new kind of fusion east-west city. That has never occurred before. The West has cities that have a lot of immigrants, but the language of those cities is entirely indigenous. For example, I live in New York, and New York's a more mixed city than Bangkok in some ways. But its language is really English. In Bangkok, there are two languages, English and Thai, and maybe you could also argue Japanese, because Japanese is spoken in a lot of places, in exclusivity. So the actual culturally, the city itself is schizophrenic, if you like, by its very nature. Well, schizophrenic is the wrong word. That implies that it's some kind of disorder. It could just be something else. It could be bipolar, but not in the depression sense. I mean, bipolar, it's really just a city in which has which is just heterogeneous by its very nature. I notice on the SkyTrain when I'm in Bangkok, you look at all these school kids who are like 10 or 11 around you on the train. And they're all speaking English, exactly like me. They've all been brought up in these English language schools. And apparently they're the first generation in which that's true. So they're speaking in a language that their parents don't understand. And that is a sort of coming generation in Asia, I think, that is perfectly anglophonic. I believe Bangkok is the most anglophone city in Asia after Singapore. So this is, and also, that's always fascinated me, that you could have a new sort of culture that's being hatched in a new kind of city.
This issue of the linguistic environment of Bangkok is something I certainly wanted to get into, because I didn't actually realize that it was, alongside Singapore, one of the most anglophone cities in Asia. But as well, the issue of your own comprehension of the Thai language comes up in the book several times, where I like how you described how it was kind of a wall, maybe a translucent wall you didn't want to break around yourself. Could you expand a little bit on that? What was that like to have that barrier kind of maybe deliberately to an extent kept up?
Yeah, I mean, when I first arrived there, I was living in a house that was rented from a cousin of the king, who's a friend of a friend. And I, of course, changed her name in the book to, protect her privacy, but she is a lovely woman. She went to school in England, and she's one of these bilingual Thai people who is completely, her brain, half of her brain is English speaking, and she speaks English like you and I do. So that's her mental universe is already, and has been since she was 4 years old. But the house that I was renting had a staff of four. There was a gardener, and there was a groundsman, a sort of family who lives on the ground. And they spoke not one word of English. They spoke only Thai. So there was a sort of linguist. First of all, language was determined by the Thai class structure. You had this upper class woman who speaks perfect English, as did all her friends. And then you have the lower class Thais who were living in the house who only spoke Thai. Now, of course, I was very interested in that, and I wrote about it in the book, conjecturing where these people came from and so on. But I had to learn Thai to communicate with them. because I couldn't really function day by day. I was just there alone in my house during that period for months on end. So I thought, well, okay, I need to learn the language and basically be able to talk to them. And also, I was just curious about how they saw the world. Yeah, I mean, for example, they would always ask me if I saw ghosts on the property, and they had a whole vocabulary for ghosts, you know, which is like one of those things. I don't think you'd learn that in language school. I don't think they teach you the 25 different varieties of ghosts. But these people had those languages because they were always asking me, did you see this ghost? Did you see that ghost? Do you know what the ghost was? So the supernatural dimension of people, the folk view of the world, which those people had, was accessed for me through the language. Not at a very sophisticated level, but at a sort of basic vocabulary level. All that was fascinating to me. Now, the war was less about the spoken language, because as spoken language is very simple. Once you've mastered the tones, we don't master the tones, but it's very grammatically and syntactically extremely simple. It's not like Japanese. It's very complicated. It's very direct, concrete, and it's a very pleasurable language to speak and listen to, because it's so direct. But the written language is, of course, a variant of Sanskrit. So you have this, you know, I could understand the oral language just like they could, but I found it very hard. I really could never get to grips with the written language. And I did, in certain parts of the city where the English, the ubiquitous English slogans and the English, you know, stuff, instructions recede a bit, the more time passed, I really did relish that sort of oral incomprehension. Because you feel more and more lost the more you feel. And I wonder what Bangkok was like 100 years ago, when there was no English thought, no English writing at all. Everything was in Thai script. It must have been extraordinary. I mean, it would have completely disorientating, and it must have been impossible to actually, function it. Now it's become anglophonic, not only orally, but in terms of its written language. So in the book, I try to kind of render that sometimes the absurdity of that, when you see these very weird English slogans all over the place, all over the malls and the restaurants. You know, the transport system, you see these kind of weird exhortatory slogans everywhere, and it's kind of pidgin English. It's kind of very, you know, fashion is the new black, the Odyssey.
Yeah, yes.
Where on earth do they get that?
this reminds me of, you, as I'm sure you know, the whole, there's a whole kind of culture built around the funny things that the Japanese put in English on their shirts and their signs and whatnot. But seems entirely different. This is on a different level of not weirdness, but I mean, this isn't just mistakes being made. This hints at like a deeper well of foreignness, as you mentioned.
Absolutely. Remember, I mean, my son is a Japanese scholar. He lives in Tokyo quite a bit, and he studies Japanese very, very seriously. And Chinese as well, but when he would come and visit me in Bangkok, he would say, you know, in Tokyo, nobody really speaks English at all. I mean, they do, but not, you know, it's not really, it's much more centered on the Japanese language. English, as they call it, is this sort of, marketing language that's, you know, that papers over. In Thailand, it's very different because of this phenomenon I just described, where people are learning a language from a very young age. So you have a sort of part of the population, particularly the young part of the population, that is genuinely anglophonic. And that's because the Thais assume that nobody's ever going to learn Thai, so they've got to learn English or die, as it were. And even their very important business relationship with the Japanese is all conducted in English. It's a very different thing. You can have a social life in Bangkok that is entirely conducted in English, and it's, you know, you don't feel displaced for a moment.
Now, how common is it for a Westerner to, as for example you did, actually try to get a handle on the Thai language?
Well, I think most of the people who live there for a long time, they speak Thai better than me in many ways. Just because it's so, for example, taxis don't speak English, which is kind of a strange, you know, despite all that, it's kind of weird. Taxis don't speak very good English. So you learn Thai, you know, your first Thai you learn is to actually direct taxis around. Remember, Bangkok doesn't have a street grid because it was never colonized. It was never a colonial city. It doesn't have big European-style boulevards that intersect in a rational way. What you have is this, like, you know, ball of twine, kind of these, you know, thousands of these tiny little streets which are paved over canals, all of which have, you know, so to actually direct your way in that labyrinth house. I was also a taxi driver, a learned taxi driver at Thai, which is quite complicated, you know, just to actually sort of get to go to exactly the place that you want to go. So there's that, you know, you need to, I don't think you can really function there on that level unless you speak Thai, but you can function on a much more exalted social level without it at all. You know, I mean, you can have love affairs, you can have marriages, you can have business associates, you can have, you can run your own company without speaking a word of Thai. And people do that.
And on the issue of the Westerners in Thailand, the ones that you bring up, the expats you talk about associating with in the book, there, I mean, dare I say, something of a motley crew. What is the nature of the Western expat in Bangkok as opposed to ones you would meet and talk to in other countries?
Well, the people who end up in Bangkok, I mean, there's some crossover. You'll see expats who will live anywhere for tax reasons or to start companies, or you know, you can retire to Thailand for $25,000. You put it in you can stick it in a bank account, and they'll you're allowed to live there. You're allowed to migrate there legally. So it's actually, you know, they want people to go there and start businesses and so on. But of course, Southeast Asia, I think I use the phrase in the book, it's the modern Tahiti. I mean, people go there, they wash up on its shores because they want a new lease on life. Well, they want to avoid the inexorable, sorry, drama, or what Jack Kerouac called, you know, the forlorn rags of growing old. There's something, I mean, I wanted this book to be melancholy and sad. I mean, that was the dominant mode. I think I don't know those men from the inside out, of course, but I can observe them that they are similar to, you know, me in background and race and language. And I can, you know, I think I know why they're there. They're there to spend the last third of their lives in a place that offers them some pleasures reminiscent of their youth, if you like. So it's also a place for exile, for escape, cheap healthcare. There are a number of things which, if you put them all together, are quite attractive. I mean, I often wonder what one does in New York relative to healthcare. It's a terrifying prospect, frankly. The amount of money you need to actually get healthcare here, if something seriously goes wrong. Whereas in Bangkok, you don't need that much money to get world-class healthcare. That may sound like a trivial reason for most people for relocating, but it's not as trivial as you think. And I think as healthcare in certain countries in the West becomes more and more irrationally expensive and absurd, people are migrating for that reason, believe it or not. But obviously, it has to be other things as well. The sadness, the melancholy, comes from the fact that you're sort of lost in a culture that barely recognizes you. I mean, the Thais are very hospitable and very tolerant. I mean, they seem to have taken in those people as their charges, and they benevolently ignore them. But sometimes being benevolently ignored is quite a privilege. It's sometimes better than the alternative. And then again, you could say that every man has his own reason. And those reasons are always somewhat mysterious, perhaps, even to the individual.
The men you describe hanging out with there, who were there maybe for perhaps the same reasons in Bangkok, you describe them, there is a certain cloud of sadness around them, but they themselves don't seem particularly displeased with their lives. Is that at all accurate on my part to make that assumption?
Yeah, I think there is a kind of rollicking glee, a certain kind of, I mean, look, you know, on a certain level, on a certain animal level, Bangkok is a very fun, hedonistic place. It's not a miserable place. Obviously, people who are themselves deeply sad are not going to go somewhere that's deeply sad. You know, I can't imagine those guys moving to Vladivostok. That would just be reconfirming the horror. People want to reconfirm the horror. One wants to go out. I mean, look, the end of life is grim, however you look at it. You want to go out with a bang. One wants to go out, as someone actually once said, I want to go out with as much disgrace as possible. So in a way, it's sort of that, isn't it? I mean, I think it's this. And I suppose a lot of people in their 50s get divorced, or they lose their jobs, or they come to the end of their sort of crappy careers. Or, you know, I mean, I think we do have this sunny myth that everyone has a wonderful, fulfilling life in Western countries. And you know what? They don't. They don't have fun, fulfilling lives. A lot of people, as T.S. Eliot said, lead lives of quiet desperation. And I think Bangkok is almost being created to cater people who lead lives of quiet desperation. There's a kind of companionship of the street that you can have there, which the West has lost. This is an interesting subtext to the whole book, and perhaps a very important one, really much more important than the sex trade, per se. I remember when I moved to Paris when I was very young in the 80s, and it was a city of ebullient street life. It would have been recognized by Henry Miller immediately. There was this feeling of turbulent life in the streets. Wonderful, you know, it was like a place, if you were poor and hard up and lonely, you could just go down to the street. And, you know, it was great. That's all disappeared. You go to Paris now, and it's a bureaucratic museum. I mean, the streets are just emptied out. And that's true of most, it's true of New York, actually, in many ways. Even New York, you know. So that's a sort of, if you ask those guys, I'm sure they wouldn't give that as a reason, but I think it is a reason. When you go to, in Bangkok, you can still be lonely and hard up, and then at the end of the day, you can still go down into the street, and you can find the kind of communal life which is takes you out of yourself. Does that make any sense?
It does, and of course, it brings to mind a point you make in the book, or something you say, which is that in Bangkok, as opposed to, well, let's say, any Western country, one leads a life where one occasionally gets touched.
Yes, one gets touched. Yeah, it's like sort of sitting in one of those restaurants. I remember sitting my first sort of lonely few weeks. I was sitting in this little place outside on Soy 38. I was sitting there eating my miserable soup by myself. I felt this kind of I felt someone touching the back of my neck. And I kind of like, in this really probing, strange kind of way, I turned around and it was a baby elephant. It was standing next to me. Just reached over and wanted to sniff behind my ear. And after my first moment of kind of like shrieking, you know, terror, I actually just sort of, everyone around me just said, calm down. Just let yourself be touched by the baby elephant. I mean, I'm not saying people go to Bangkok to be touched by elephants, but, you know, you can be touched by an elephant. And, you know, you can be touched by other human beings, this whole sort of massage culture, which everyone thinks is just sort of sleazy sex, but it's not. Actually, there's also the, you know, Thai tradition of massage per se, which everyone seems to indulge in twice a day. Now, this may sound trivial, but I can assure you that having yourself massaged for 3 hours a day puts you in an excellent frame of mind. much of your neurosis and anxiety and stress miraculously disappears. And it's to do with this sort of tactile connection, which is accessible to everybody. You can get yourself massaged for 2 hours for $5. And it's this sort of, I actually think just experientially, myself, day by day, this constant sort of being touched by other human beings is enormously healing. I really do believe that.
And getting the 3 hours of massage a day in New York is what, $600? Maybe even more?
Well,
$800? You know, depending on where you go, I can't imagine. It ain't $5, I'll say that.
Yeah, let's say 10, 15, you know. I mean, especially if you have those sort of... And I just thought, one thing they love about Bangkok is those enormous foot massage parlors where you see all the commuters coming back from work. And they're all on the way to work, too. They're all sitting side by side in these enormous parlors having their feet massaged. It's all very jolly, you know, reading the paper or whatever. It seems like such a wonderful end to the day to go to a foot massage parlor, read the paper, have a glass of tea, and have your feet pounded. I think it's a kind of, it's one of those sort of merry, tactile experiences which we just don't have, you know. It's just not something that, and I noticed the change in my own moods and my own state of mind when I'm back living here. Compared to when I'm living in Thailand. And I'm a lot more stressed. I can tell you that.
There's something that is actually, it's notable by its absence, and I'm glad that it's absent from your book, is I think one thing a reader might expect while starting to read the book is that you will wind up in a position of saying, well, the hedonism and the pleasure of Bangkok is all well and good, but nothing beats sort of going back to England and miserably eating a boiled dinner or something.
What the hell was that? No, I don't believe that. I don't think it. I think Asia has a lot going for it, actually, in that. And also, why is Asia the most dynamic place on the planet now? Well, I mean, you can say, I mean, I don't think anyone really knows why. It's much less regulated across the board than Western countries are. We know why we have regulation. We regulate life because we think we're making it more moral or more ethical or more responsible. And I can see that. You know, I'm not blind to the dark side of Asia or the dark side of Bangkok. But there's a danger that the West is sort of regulating itself out of existence. And, you know, our massive web of regulation didn't help much with the financial meltdown, did it?
No.
You know, there's where regulation was really needed, and where money was really at stake and corruption was really at stake, there was bugger all regulation at all. Yeah, there was just nothing there. So we certainly sure as hell regulated everything else. We, the little people, are definitely regulated to death. There's a feeling in Asia that the ordinary people are not as... This is a nice, general day-to-day life. Feels freer, in a way. Not freer in every respect. There's a lot of censorship in Thailand relative to Liz Major's Day, which is ridiculous. You know, of course, you know, we all recognize that. But there's a kind of... and there's a lot of mad, irrational regulation and corruption in Thailand as well. It's just that it doesn't work very well. So... I feel there's a kind of day-by-day laxity, tolerance, looseness, loose-limbedness, if you like, in day-by-day life there that I can't quite put my finger on, but I definitely feel it. When I go back to America or Western Europe now, I feel like I'm in a sort of highly orderly, bureaucratic box. You can do a lot of creative things, and you can express more than you can in Thailand in some ways. But you're still in this sort of much more controlled and rigid environment. I mean, I feel in the United States, the presence of the police surveillance is much heavier, much more intrusive. I mean, for reasons of terrorism and all that. Of course, they have terrorism in Thailand, too, the war in the South. But you don't have so much surveillance intrusion.
If you've just tuned in, this is The Marketplace of Ideas. I'm Colin Marshall. You can hear this show again or any other interview from the Marketplace of Ideas archives at colinmarshallradio.com. My guest is Lawrence Osborne, novelist, journalist, memoirist, world traveler, whose newest book is Bangkok Days, A Sojourn in the Capital of Pleasure. I'm reminded of the articles that I read about Thailand, putting a lot of what goes on the street level to the country's, you know, Buddhist morality as opposed to a Judeo-Christian morality like we'll have in the West.
How much
do you agree with that, those sorts of assertions?
I kind of agree with it, but I couldn't really back it up intellectually. You know, I mean, if a scholar, you know, of these religions would have challenged me on that point, I'd probably melt away ignominiously. I wouldn't really know how to prove it, you know. But insofar as you can feel those things intuitively, I think it's got to be true, right? It has to be. I mean, on some level, it has to be true. You know, Thailand is not just a Buddhist country in name. It's what everyone practices. So there must be an ethos that springs from that. I'm not sure I understand it. I'm not sure I understand Buddhism. I'm not sure I understand what Buddhism really is about. You know, I've read a lot of books on Buddhism. I'm very interested in Buddhism, if you like, iconographically. I'm very interested in Buddhist art and so on. And I try to understand it, try to study it. But, you know, what its deep core is, in a specific country, I mean, in Thailand, that's much more difficult. But I think you're right. I think the Judeo-Christian view of the world, let's face it, even though we're secular, we're still Judeo-Christian, through and through. And it's quite funny to see how quickly Thai spot that. For example, our obsession with the sex business is very Judeo-Christian. It just is, you know. And Thai are constantly saying to me, or constantly saying to one, what is it with you people? Why are you always talking about sex all the time? For us, it's just an itch that has to be scratched. We don't make a religious drama out of it. But you're always making a drama out of it. You're always talking about it. You're always obsessing about it. We find it very peculiar. So, you know, it had never really occurred to me before going there that might be true.
I did like the line you draw in the book between European and any Thai view of sexuality, where in Europe you have those who profess this total hedonism but are inhibited when you get down to it. In Thailand, it's the reverse. They profess proper propriety, and then they'll kind of do what they want when behind closed doors.
Yeah, respectability, and I sympathize more with the Thais in this one. They don't have pseudo-liberation as their facade. They have what in Thai is called riap roi, which is this sort of facade of respectability. And now we say, oh, that's hypocrisy. Well, that's a very primitive way of looking at it. I mean, there is a sort of, why is the facade necessary? I think that societies do need facades in some ways. I mean, there's a sort of order, because it produces a kind of order, and it makes people behave in a certain way relative to the structure of the family and to social cohesion. Yeah, in a society which has historically been very poor and struggling and upwardly mobile, this is true all over the world, yet you have a society in which takes order very seriously, because the consequences of disorder are an immediate return to poverty, and they're very haunted by poverty. I mean, you don't have to go very far back in any Thai family's history to find grinding rural poverty, one generation, two generations. So the near presence of poverty spurs them to be very insistent upon order, on the level of certain kinds of conduct, the way it seems. So, you can, as long as you fulfill your duties and you don't shame or dishonor anybody, then your private behavior is your private behavior. Nobody talks about your private behavior. The West is the other way around. You have this supposed liberation and hedonism. Everybody assesses about everybody else's private behavior. Look at our gossip industry relative to... It's all about sexual scandals, isn't it? I mean, it's just like, what are people doing? What are people getting up to in their bedrooms? It's completely absurd. Most of Gawker and the New York Post is about... sex lives are about. Even though other people's sex lives are completely unknown to us, they're completely, this speculation has no meaning. It has no, what could it possibly be about? I mean, I don't know what my neighbor is doing, and I don't want to know. It's not any of my business.
I take it in Bangkok you saw no evidence of this sort of tabloid inflation of the sexual
details.
Well,
they do have a very thriving tabloid thing. And they do have some sexual problems, but much of it is about money and about corruption and stuff. And I don't think, because my impression, although I don't read Thai very well, my impression is that it's not endlessly obsessing about. Because I think in the West it comes with a very snarky kind of very nasty tone, which you do not have in Thailand. That you definitely do not have. At least I don't think you do.
Is it also one of those Asian countries without much irony?
Well, irony is a difficult, that's a good question, actually. They don't have as much irony as we do, that's true. But again, I don't know if that's just my own crudity. I think they do. I think I gave a lecture at the Rubin Museum recently with a Thai artist, Jakai Suriputra, who's actually quite a famous artist in Bangkok. And I had drinks with Jakai afterwards, and I was delighted by his subtle and playful irony. And I just wondered to myself, perhaps I didn't know enough people like that when I was in Bangkok. One never knows if one's getting the whole picture. I think irony comes into play at a very high level of exchange. I mean, when you're talking to somebody who's at the same sort of level as yourself and who's, you're talking about things that are of interest to both of you, then the subtlety of irony can come into play. Because irony is not sarcasm. I would say they have much less snark and sarcasm. But because sarcasm is a kind of condemnation of something. It's a kind of hatred of something, ultimately. Irony is the belief that two versions of the world may be true at exactly the same moment. And that it's... fundamentally, it's an act, a gesture of gentleness and tolerance. And I think Thais have that. They do, irony in that sense, Thais definitely have that. I notice that if you make a small social gaffe, that everyone will laugh in a very lovely way. And they look at you in that sort of slightly winky way. They understand that, But they, yeah, they have irony in that sense.
They won't laugh in a ridiculing way you'd see on TV.
No. I mean, I think that's right. I think that hard edge of mocking malevolence, which I personally detest in at a cultural level and a personal level, they have a lot less of that. That need to humiliate.
Now, when you're assembling this book, I want to make sure to ask this. What was always, or if anything was, what was at the forefront of your mind as what needed to be conveyed to your readers about Bangkok?
I wanted to convey primarily the joy and the pleasure of it. You know, and I wanted to write a book that was joyful. Sad, I mean, you know, sad and melancholy and so forth. But I just think to myself how rare it is that you read a book that makes you glad to be alive. You know, but in a way, I remember someone writing about one of Henry Miller's books, I think it was maybe Trophy of Cancer. And I can't remember who said it, but he said it's as if all the champagne corks in the world went off at the same time. And I don't know why that remark moves me so much. I think it's such a beautiful compliment to pay a writer. It's such a beautiful thing to say about what a writer has tried to do. Because then the writing is a sort of, it is a gift in a way. I mean, if you felt the pleasure of living at that moment in time and place, time and place, then what could be better than to convey it to somebody else? So there's a very simple reason. I mean, that was my gut reason. That's one of the reasons that attracted me to Bangkok in the first place, after all.
Now, is it true that it was also cheap dentistry?
Very cheap dentistry, but, you know, cheap dentistry is very much a part of the pleasure of life. because its absence inflicts great pain and anxiety, which detracts from the pleasure of life. You know, I have dental insurance in the United States, but it only covers 50%, so it's enormously expensive to get your teeth done here. So I discovered these amazing U.S. board-certified dentists in Bangkok. Some of them are American, actually, operating for a fraction of the cost. And I love getting my teeth done there. I actually look forward to it. And the clinics are like James Bond facilities, and staff are, all dentists in Bangkok are women, actually. Women predominate in certain medical professions, in biotechnology and in certain medical professions. Dentistry is one of them. So, you know, it's an all-female environment. And I don't say that in a sexist way. I mean, it's actually, I think women are just more sort of considerate and gentle when they're doing your teeth. That's just my impression anyway.
Now, to make a book of your personal experiences, to make it both sad and joyful, that sounds like a very challenging and balancing act. And I do think you've succeeded, but what did that require of you to balance those emotions into this book of things that actually happened to you?
I think I decided to step back from them and just look at them comically. I mean, I almost died there from an infection of the epiglottis in that whole episode that's described in the book of being in a hospital. I mean, that was a sort of pretty harrowing. It was a lot more harrowing than I made it sound. I mean, I really came close to that was pretty unpleasant. But I thought, what's the point of making a sort of drama out of it? I thought I would just step back and look at it comically. Because when I look back on it, it did seem pretty funny. I mean, and the whole thing with sharing the room with Fritzy, and he was having his testicle removed. I mean, it was sort of Monty Python. You know, Bangkok is a very Monty Python kind of place, anyway. It's so batty and surreal and strange and inherently comic. I don't know if Thais find it comic, but, you know, just the sort of the East-West collision is, I think, inherently comic. The great collision of our age, but the great fusion of our age, the great story of our age is the East and West coming together. But it's a comedy of errors, if you like. And I thought, here's a city which is a comedy of errors. The comedy of errors is what defines the place. And I thought, how wonderful. I love it, you know, because I love write a comedy of errors, and I thought this was my perfect subject matter for me, because I think that's how I see life. I see life as a comedy of errors. It's just a temperamental thing.
You found a location that then expressed your worldview in the very thing
exactly.
It was.
Exactly. It corresponded, yeah, exactly. It corresponded exactly to my feeling of the way life is. And I might add my own life. I mean, I think my own life is a comedy of errors. I see it. I insist on seeing it that way. You know, I don't. It's just a sort of. And comedy, of course, is often, as in Shakespeare, it's very sad. Nothing is sadder in Shakespeare than the comedies. You know, E.M. Forster, I'm sorry to give you so many literary quotations.
Oh, that's a good thing, not a bad thing.
I'm sorry. But E.M. Forster has this beautiful thing. He says somewhere, life is not unbearable because it's a tragedy. It's unbearable because it's a romance. And, you know, I should have made that the quote at the beginning of the book. Because that's it in a nutshell.
Perhaps in the next edition of the book, that can come at the very
maybe
front.
Maybe, if I can get rid of the subtitle.
yes, exactly. You make that sort of deal with the publisher. Now, one of the things I most appreciate about Bangkok Days is that, as I mentioned before, there's not a lot of spoon-feeding to the audience of the context that can be inferred. You know, you assume they can follow along with you and that they do want
exactly.
to understand. Now, it brought back an article that I very much enjoyed, a short piece you wrote for, I believe, The Independent a while ago that got put on Arts and Letters Daily as well, and so got passed around a lot online, which was about why publishers find themselves in the problems that they have right now,
yes.
that they dumb everything down. Now, that doesn't seem like... Well, why are so few people making that point? Because I so agree, but you seem to be the only one in recent memory doing it.
Publishers. the readers are so much smarter than the people who run the publishing. But I probably shouldn't say this on the record, but they are. The publishers who are located in these elitist, it's a silly word. I mean, but they're isolated. They're isolated geographically, culturally, many ways. And they're terrified. They think they have to deal with this dumb Oprah audience who has to be, well, that's bullshit. People, my impression from various books in this country and going on, you know, doing readings, in all sorts of places, you listen to what people say to you when they come up to you, when they sign your book. And people are sophisticated. They're smart. They really are. I mean, what a condescension to assume that they're not, that they can't understand things. The reader is much, much smarter than the publisher and editor will ever, ever assume. And that's sort of a bit of an outrage, really, isn't it? The reader doesn't want to have everything laid out. After all, there are readers and readers. I mean, look, you know, not everybody is going to read your book. I mean, the audience for a book like this might be quite small, but it doesn't have to be enormous. It just has to be able to get it and, you know, able to enjoy it and so on. That's, you know, in relative terms, it's not that small a number of people. You don't have to spoon-feed them everything. You can, and I think, my feeling as a reader is that I enjoy not knowing everything. I enjoy inferring myself. I enjoy obliquity. I enjoy, you know, not being led by the nose ploddingly. It's like those plots, those potboiler plots of books of bestsellers where everything is laid out. And you just go, well, okay, I know exactly what's coming down the railway track right now. I don't want to be hit by that train. I'd rather... You know, it's like watching a movie where you know every single... It's funny that, in a way, that, you know, people who make movies are more savvy about this than the people who, you know, publish books. But I don't know. And now, you know, sadly, publishing is in total crisis. And I said in that piece that I thought the crisis was as much self-inflicted as it is about any kind of financial crisis. And I think that's true. I think it's a very mismanaged industry. None of us who have, I have a lot of dealings with publishing, but none of us can figure out what its model is, business model is. It just doesn't add up, you know.
It has a bit of the occult to it.
Yeah, there's a bit of the occult to it. And, you know, I wonder, of course, way too many books are published, and that's also true. I mean, you've got this massive glut of books. But, you know, book readership is rising, not declining. People are reading more, not less. Probably because we're all sick and tired of this nauseating media and celebrity culture. That's just a load of crap. It doesn't sustain us, any of us, really. The readership is rising, and so on, and our publishers responding to that. I have great hope, and this is, of course, what a lot of writers say, perhaps in a knee-jerk way, but I have a lot of hope in the smaller publishers that are much more mobile and are picking up the slack, I think, and doing great things. And I've noticed in review pages that a lot of books published by, Grey Wolf or Servant Sale, all these smaller publishing houses, are getting a lot of play. They're getting a lot of exposure. So that's good.
I'm going to draw a sort of strained final analogy here between, as you mentioned, in Bangkok, people being on their best behavior in many ways because they chronologically are not far from poverty. Now, I think of the publishing industry, which hasn't had to struggle for itself for a while and is no longer, has become disordered and in some sectors dissolute. Perhaps it needs some kind of crisis to remind them of the fate they could experience?
I think that's absolutely true. I think it's become wanton, and it's 5 million bucks for Tom Friedman's last book. By my, that's outrageous. perhaps I should be careful. That's my publishing house. But it's cheap. But, across the board, people are still awarding vast advances. I mean, where they can, to celebrity books and so on. Those advances never earn back. It's just, it's the curse of celebrity culture. What I love about Bangkok, by the way, is there are no celebrities there.
Oh.
I mean, there are local celebrities, but one just leaves that whole sort of oppressive celebrity culture. When you come back here, it's amazing in America just to see the kind of psychotic obsession with it. Publishing is, has a chip on its shoulder about Hollywood, I suspect. A lot of people going into publishing who shouldn't be in publishing, really. They should be corporate lawyers, or they should be on Wall Street, or they should be in Hollywood. They shouldn't be doing books. Books are, the beauty of books is that they are passed on from hand to hand, from ear to ear, by word of mouth. They are a form of oral knowledge in some ways. They are not necessarily the beneficiaries of huge media PR blitz campaigns. Everyone thinks they are. I was reading a piece by Alain de Botton the other day where he was saying that if a book doesn't have a huge PR campaign behind it, it becomes invisible. Well, I beg to disagree. I don't think that's the way books spread along the grapevine. And that is a measure of their authenticity in a way, because people don't pass on things to other people unless they enjoyed it and they got something from it. And there is this sort of just this quiet movement where a book gets... I think that's so beautiful in this age, in this digital media age. The idea of something being handed, literally, from person to person, is so subversive and it's so human, in the deepest way. Maybe it's the most important thing of all, and why books will survive.
I very much like that way of thinking about it. I'm going to pass that idea off as my own now when I talk to people.
Good. That's what you're here for, to spread that, word. Yeah.
The title of the book, once again, is Bangkok Days. I will leave the misleading subtitle off for now. Lawrence, thank you so much for taking the time to come on the program.
Thank you very much.
If you'd like more information about Lawrence Osborne, visit lawrenceosborne.net. This has been the Marketplace of Ideas. I've been Colin Marshall. As always, our music is produced by Ben Althaus, except for the song you're hearing right now, of course. For more info on him, visit benalthaus.com. If you'd like to hear this show again or any other in the Marketplace of Ideas archive, visit colinmarshallradio.com. Thank you for tuning in, and we will catch you next time.